السلام عليكم.
عليكم السلام.
السلام عليكم.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله.
عليكم السلام دكتور.
Okay guys, before I start, can you hear and see the presentation?
Yes, Dr. Rukanti.
Again,
yes,
for
sir.
The second time, can you hear and listen to my voice?
Yes.
Okay guys, inshallah, we'll start a new topic today. I'm not sure what time is it now? We still have 2 minutes? 3 minutes, okay, we have to wait. By the way, somebody sent me a question about, I think, buckling or something like this. And I promised, inshallah, that I will discuss it with him after during the class. Once we finish the topic, inshallah, I will get back to his question. I don't know who asked that question, but let me get to my WhatsApp. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. سينك خالد الحربي، are you there خالد؟ اوكي، let me look for his problem before we start. Well, it's better to keep it like this. I'm worried that we might lose the voice. Okay, let's wait for another. I think we are exactly on time, right? Is it 3 p.m. now?
Yes, doctor.
Yes, doctor.
Okay, guys. Alhamdulillah, I was able to upload the marks of the assignment, and assignment number one and the quiz number one. And inshallah, tomorrow by the end of the day, inshallah, inshallah, you'll be able to upload also the marks of the midterm. The people keep asking me about this, and I kept telling them it's okay. Once I'm done with everything, I'm gonna upload it. There is no benefit behind like delaying uploading the marks. Actually, as you can see, guys, alhamdulillah, we can call it our trip, our journey, or whatever. In that course, we are about to come to the 60 to 70% out of the course. By this class, alhamdulillah. So let me explore quickly what we did since we started that course. We're starting by refreshing your memory about some important topics in the mechanics of material, and then we switch it to the very first class in our syllabus, which is with chapter 3. And if you remember, guys, this chapter 3 was about what? Somebody remind me about chapter 3. What did we study in chapter 3, guys? Didn't we study the force analysis and the stress analysis and the relation between power and torque and all this stuff? And then we ended up by having what's called the stress element. And we have two types of stress elements, two-dimensional or three-dimensional stress elements. Okay, remember all this. And then after finishing chapter 3, then we started chapter 4, which was about?
Deflection.
Deflection.
The deflection. Yes. Okay, how many deflections we studied?
We studied the deflection and the buckling.
Yes, so we have a deflection. Due to under the lateral load, which is directly caused by the lateral load itself, and the other very special kind of deflection, which is due to axial load, okay, which is buckling. And we studied four cases in the buckling. I mean four scenarios for the end condition, and based on each scenario, we can pick up what's called the fixation constant or C. And if you remember, in we have two ways to go. Either we go with Euler based on the slenderness ratio, okay, or we go with what's called the parabolic form, and this parabolic form is coming from both of them actually are coming from like experiments, so we call them empirical formulas. It's not coming from scratch, coming from like so theoretical derivation or something like this. So alhamdulillah, we were able also to finish that part. And then we switch it to chapter 5, which is very important about the theories of Fourier. And if you go back to the title, the first page in that in this series of courses, the series of lectures, we said static theories of Fourier, which means that there are also a dynamic. When I say static, it means that on the opposite side, there is also dynamic theories of Fourier. But actually, this will last for almost like 3 to 4 weeks. So I prefer to postpone it to the end of the course. And this week, inshallah, we will take like separate topics. So by the end of the class, inshallah, we'll be able to finish each topic by the end of the class. Not like before, we used to take like 2 or 3 lectures to finish up our chapter. No, in this coming series of lectures, and I intentionally did that actually, because sometimes you feel very bored if you are all the time you are studying a topic that you did not finish within one class. You take 2 or 3 classes to finish up. So I want to actually, I did not go through the original arrangements for the chapter. No, I just skipped some of the chapters and I postponed it to the end, because I know your benefit as a student out of my view as a teacher or instructor. So today, inshallah, we will study how to design a permanent joint. And one of these very famous permanent joints are welding, okay? And again, guys, once you hear the permanent joints, then for sure we'll study another joints which is non-permanent. So I told you that the permanent joints, one of these very famous examples for the permanent joints are the welding. On the opposite side, out of your engineering sense, could you please tell me what is the joints which could be classified as non-permanent, that and inshallah that we will study this week or next week, inshallah?
Yes, maybe Dr. Jones, that can move.
The joints can
like
move?
Like bolts.
Yes,
nuts and bolts.
No. Let me go to the second opinion, actually. See, moving, letting your mechanical bars having a relative motion does not mean that they are connected with non-permanent joints. They could also be connected with a permanent joints. For example, let me give you a very, very, very quick example on this. Let's assume that we have a crank. Okay. And this crank is connected with another link. Like this. And there is an opening here, and the opening, of course, in that one on the back. And these two links are somehow used in some of the mechanical application. And there is a relative motion, which means that the angle in between could be increased or decreased. So the way you connect this one, there are different ways. Either you use bolts, bolt and nuts, which is non-permanent, or the other way is to bring something like a pin. And this pin has a big head on the other side, and on the next side, actually, you block that pin with a welded part. So although there is a relative motion between these two elements, but still the connection in between, or the joint in between, is a permanent. When I say permanent, means, guys, the only way to take this or dismantle these two pieces is just by breaking up that part. And if I told you that this part is welded to another part by welding material, okay? So the only way to take these two parts off or to separate these two parts is to break the welding. Am I right or wrong? So once you hear the word break, fracture, this means that your joint was originally a permanent joint, okay? Same story, if I need to take these two off or to dismantle these two parts away from each other, the only way is to break the head of that bin. And once you hear the word break, this means that your joint was already a permanent. But if you are talking about bolt and the screw, let's say that this is the head of our bolt, okay? And this is the chunk, el jism nafsu, of the bolt. then the only way is to take this one off is just to unscrew your nut, السمولة نفسها. Okay guys, so this nut could be unscrewed, and then you'll be easily able to dismantle or to take these two parts off. You got it guys? So once you can do it without any failure, without any causing any damage, then I can claim that this joint is a non-permanent non-permanent joint. So now you see the difference between both. If we get back to our class today, which is welding, sometimes actually we come to the two welded bars. As you can see guys, we can claim that this is like some kind of a front view. This is originally your drawing. It is a hollow cylindrical shape, and this cylindrical shape is attached to a back wall, as you can see in that picture. Okay, and either you put the welding from outside, which is practically accepted, or you can put it from inside, which is very difficult. In some cases we put inside, but if this if the area inside area allows us to get in to get inside. Okay, and in some application it's very difficult to get inside, so the only way is to make your welding on on the outside surface. Anyway, as you can see, as an engineer guys, should all the time when we express the location or when we show the location of our welding in our engineering drawing, should we make this like gray spots? Of course it's not accepted, because if you remember guys, the mechanical drawing is some kind of a special language between engineers, which is mainly based on symbols. Yani for example, when I give you something like this and I give you this arrowhead up and down there in the mechanical drawing, then you understand that this line is called the extension line, this one is called dimension line, and whatever in between is the dimension itself. Okay, and if I wrote down something like this beside that number, then you figure out that that this is a diameter. And when you say diameter, it means that the only accepted shape cross section for that word is circular. You got it guy, you got this one? So again, as long as we started this kind of very special language, which is mechanical drawing or in technical drawing, in order for these civil people not to get angry with us, so we can call technical drawing, you can see also that also for the welding, you can express your welding using this kind of symbols. First of all, you are using that arrowhead, and this arrowhead, there is another line which is very similar. If you remember guys, when you refer to any circle inside your mechanical drawing, there are different ways to express the dimension of that circle. Either you put this one inside and then you put an opposite arrowhead, and then you put that horizontal line, and beside the horizontal line you write down something like 3R. So you understand that this is a circular shape which has a radius of 3 units. These units could be inch, meter, millimeter. It's not our business now. Okay, same story. Whenever I express any the welded area, I have to express that welded area, I have to refer to the location of the welded area by arrowhead. Okay, and now if your shape has like some kind of circumference, it doesn't matter guys if this one has circular or non-circular shape. You might have something like this, which is crystal clear that this is non-circular, this is like elliptic shape. You got it? And whenever I need to express that there is a welding on this whole circumference, I put that arrowhead, and to tell him that the welding is taking place not only at this exact spot that I'm referring to, it's taking the whole circumference. Then in this case, I have to put that circle at the corner. So you see, arrowhead is referring to to one of the locations of your welding, application of your welding. The circular at the corner means that your welding is taking the circular shape. Okay, now what about this one? This one actually is expressing the shape of the weld itself, because sometimes of the weld, some shapes of the welding might be something like this. It could take that shape, some of the welding could take that shape. Okay, and some of the welding, which is very recommended actually in cases like this, is to take that that shape. So now guys, as you can see, once the arrowhead, be careful, because actually you have this, you have that side of the of the arrow, which is we call close to the arrow location, and this is away from the arrow location. If the triangle that you draw on that baseline, on that referring line, if that triangle has a head down, it means that your welding is applied directly to the location that you are referring to. In other words, guys, if I need to tell you that there is a welding on the circumference, that's fine. Up to this point, you know that there is a welding on the circumference, but there are two cases here. There are two possibilities here. The first possibility is to apply your welding on the outer surface, as we did here. But if my welding was inside, like this, you got my point? In another case, if I need to express it with like a very regular language between anybody, it's just to make another circular shape here and make this one gray. And erase that one. So this, you'll understood from that picture or from that front view that there is a welding, but this welding is not on the outer diameter, it's on the inner diameter. Now, how can I express it on this shape? Same story, you start by adding, although your welding is not here, it's inside, but you still can refer to the same A, similar location. But and you put also circular A, you put circle there, but the only thing that you have to be aware of, which is the direction of the triangle. If the direction of the triangle is getting up like this, this means that your welding is on the opposite of the A location that you are referring to. Is it clear? This point is clear, guys, or not clear?
Yes, clear. Yes.
Doctor, what does the circle mean?
I told you from the beginning. Once you see circular, it means that your welding is going through the whole circumference. It's not only at the location where you are referring to.
Okay.
You got it?
Okay. So only for circular shapes or?
Reda. Okay. I have feeling that you sleep, you have a nap for a while, and then you are asking me to repeat what I said. Guys, didn't I say that there is another example for circumferential application, which is like that non-circular shape, the ellipse shape? Did I say or
yes.
Not, guys?
Yes, Dr.
Okay. So please don't waste my time by just keep repeating very trivial information. This is just beginning, okay?
And Dr., the number, which is number 5.
Yeah, see, I was about to finish and then go to the number, but because I have been asked that question, then I have taken from the way of my the stream of my thinking. Anyway, that number, guys, is referring to something is the weld height, because actually if you are looking at that triangular shape, usually we call that length, we call it this one and that one because they are symmetric. As you can see, this is 45 degree triangle. We call that one weld, listen to these names. We call it sometimes weld size. Okay? And usually that number is in millimeter. Even if I did not tell you that this is millimeter, by default, this number is in millimeter. Other than that, I have to say it clearly. Okay? So we call it weld size. Sometimes we call it weld height. H-E-I-G-H-T. And the third name, which is very strange a little bit, it's called weld leg. Leg, L-E-G. Okay? So these are three names for only one symbol, which is A, could be replaced by that symbol H. Okay. And because most of the A breaking or most of the failure is taking place along that plane, you can see, guys, that this area or that line from that corner to any line on the opposite chord in that triangle, you see that this is the shortest A, this is the shortest distance. And again, guys, what is the weakest point in the human body? What is the easiest point that once you attack, you know that this guy for sure will die?
The neck?
Allah inawar alaik, the neck, yes. And this is exactly what they call it here. They call this one, they call it weld neck. And sometimes, to be more specific, the only thing that you guarantee that you will kill that body in front of you, and for sure he will not survive, we call it weld the throat. If you cut the throat, sometimes you call the serial killer, they call him a throat cutter or something like this. You got it? So the name that which is very famous is weld a. Weld the throat. Okay, guys? So now, that weld the throat, we used to give it that A symbol, T. And later you will know that the relation between this T and the H, T is almost equal to 0.707 from the value of H. Okay, guys? Please remember this relation. or in another word, your h, which is the weld size, weld height or weld size, is equal to 1.4, I think 1.4 times t. Okay. Can somebody check on this if the reciprocal of that one number is equal to 0.707 before we proceed?
Yes, doctor, it is.
It is. So yes. The reciprocal of 0.707 is 1.414. Okay, and this is again the relation between the weld size or the weld leg, to use the same language, and the weld throat. Why it's called the weld throat? Because most of the failure, actually after inspection, inspecting the failed weld joints, we found that this A, most of the failure is taking place by a crack taking that A that direction. And we also found that this angle is almost a 45 degree angle. Okay, so please remember all these things or all these relations. Now, guys, I'm not going to get into a lot of details on this one, because actually the main business of interpretation of all these things there are the manufacturing people, not us as a mechanical engineer. But at least we know some of them. We know that this arrowhead is referring to the location of the welding. We also know that that circular shape refers that your welding is through the whole circumference. Okay. Sometimes they wrote this number here, as I said, the number which is 5 or 6 or 3, which is the length of the weld leg. Okay. And sometimes this is not the weld, this is not the length of the weld leg, guys. This is another story. Actually, the length of the weld leg is some number which is supposed to be written here. Yes. This is S, referred to the number which is similar to the number 5 in the A in the other drawing. But what about the story of this one? The story of this one is sometimes when you make your welding, you do not make your welding as one continuous line. You make it as some batches, and these batches actually has a certain length, which is that L mentioned there. Okay, and between the center of this batch and the next batch is a. There is a distance called the beach, الخطوة بالعربي, خطوة, step. Okay. So sometimes in some of the applications, you might have more than a one number. So this number very, very close beside the symbol, because if you remember, guys, we are using that symbol, the arrowhead up or the arrowhead A close to the A, to the side of the A, sorry, the triangle, the triangular shape, either it's in the A, in the area of the A of the arrowhead, or on the opposite area of the arrowhead. So please remember this expression, okay? So whenever you see that number beside that triangular shape, this means that this is a weld size or weld height or weld length, okay? But what about some numbers which could be written beside this one? These numbers actually, as I told you, sometimes when you apply your welding, you did not make your welding along the whole A, the whole edge of your A, of your welded part. No, sometimes you split it into A, batches like this or pieces like this, and each piece has exactly equal length to the other equal length to the other pieces, and the distance in between we call it pitch. Okay, now what about that tail? It's very rare to be used, but sometimes in some of the special application you don't need to use what's called that rod which is used in welding. They call it arc A. I forgot the name because this is some kind of manufacturing terminologies. That rod, the guys, you know, when you look at the welding machine, there is a rod, and this rod actually, under the effect of the arc welding, it fuses and it becomes the weld itself. Okay, so we can call arc rod or something, or welding rod. Okay, so sometimes the manufacturer himself does not use any regular A. Or any commonly used rod in the market. No, he's asking you to use very special A type of the rod, and that very special type actually in the rod he used to write it here is using some symbols and some numbers, as we will know later, inshallah. So this is just like small like interpretation for all these details on that arrowhead. But if you know the details, guys, very easy to go and just dig for in the YouTube, and you will see a lot of manufacturing people talking about all these details in good interpretation than me, because I'm not manufacturing man, I'm mechanical engineering man. Okay, so now what about the other symbols? As you can see, guys, the only symbol that we dealt with so far is that symbol, which is the fillet, which we make it like approximately equal to triangular shape. Sometimes we have that shape for the welding bead اللي هي على زي ال I don't know when you have your that, you know what bead means, الفص بتاع الخاتم. Whenever you have like a ring in your hand, so there is this kind of precious stone inside, we call it bead. Okay, so sometimes your welding looks like a bead, sometimes it looks like a plug اللي هي حاجة بتقفل بيها plug. You know what plug, if you have like a tank and there is an opening in that tank, so you need to block that the leak from that opening, so you put that that plug in that place. So we usually use that symbol to express that that plug. Okay, sometimes our welding looks like a square, okay, and sometimes it takes that shape, sometimes it takes that shape, which we call it bevel, sometimes it takes that U shape, sometimes it takes that J shape. Okay, where exactly are those? If these shapes we can find in the first type of welding, which is called the butt welding, BUTT. And when I say, guys, butt welding, it means that whenever you weld the two parts together, you bring them head to head like this, and then you start applying your filling in that space by your welding material. So whenever you put these two blades head to head, then we call this kind of welding butt welding. Some other kind of welding, we call it overlapped welding. Instead of putting, like, for example, I'm going to assume, guys, that these two sheets, like the end of like a, you need to create a circular tank, and you have that sheet. Okay, you have that sheet of metal, and you need to create the side wall of that circular tank. So what you need to do is just to come to that sheet, and then you will bend it like this. Okay, until you take that shape, and then once you bring these two ends of the sheet face to face, we call it butt location, then you start filling your material or the space in between by your welding material. So the way you fill it in, sometimes it takes that shape, this shape, or that shape. So what about the other? There are some other shapes, like some other methods by applying to apply your welding. Either instead of making the butt joint, you make it overlapped. Yeah, you come to this end and you keep circulating until you come in, and there is an overlap area, as you can see, guys. You see the difference between both? So this is your end of a welding here. This is the end of the sheet and the end of the sheet there. And then you start applying welding inside and welding outside. Of course, there is a reason, guys, behind either you choose this one or that one. But anyway, this is two types of the welding. So the first one, we call it butt joint, BUTT, face to face means. The other method, which is called the overlapped method. Sometimes you bring your sheet, and if this is your sheet, you put them face to face, as you can see. But you also put supporting blades from inside and from outside. So when you look from the top, your welding will look like this. Your welded area will look like this. You put this one side face to face, butt joint, but you also put some supporting blade on the top, and only so you can put it from one side or either the top or the bottom. And sometimes to make it more stronger, we make it from the two sides, and then we apply our welding. So imagine, guys, this is exactly what you can see from the if you are looking to that part from the top. Anyway, so. Again, guys, here is what I mentioned before. Remember, whenever you see some numbers like this, this means that this is the length of the spot, and then you see that 200, it means the beach, which is the space between the two consequent center of geometry of this spot line. Okay, and again, that number means that there is that this is a weld size or weld height. Okay, guys, now we need to express that one. What does this one means? Yani sometimes one of the problems, the theoretical problem that I may give to you, I might give you something like this, a shape like this, a plate, vertical plate, and then connected with a and the horizontal with a horizontal plate. Okay, and there is no any kind of drawings that tells you that there is a welding here. But what I'm gonna do, I'm gonna do something like this, guys. When I put something like this and give you that symbol, triangular shape like this, and put some number here, let's say 3. Okay, what does it mean, guys? This one doesn't, what does it mean?
It means there is a weld inside.
You mean, okay, let me tell you that this side is side number 1, and the opposite side on the back, which is I cannot see, is the side number 2. So when you see this, your triangular shape on the not in the area, not in the neighbor of the arrowhead, it's on the opposite side. So it tells you that your welding is applied where exactly?
Number 2.
Eh?
Number 2.
Are you sure?
Yes, because it should be inside.
Okay. Again, remember that example? This is the very first one that we started with.
Yes.
Just recall what we said. See, this is your arrow. This is the arrowhead. This is the area of the arrowhead, the neighborhood of the arrowhead, and this is the opposite one. You see your triangular shape where?
Down.
It's on the opposite. So again, based on your understanding here, again, do you think that your answer for the first time was wrong or right?
No, it was wrong.
It was wrong, right? Okay, yes. So this means, guys, once you see something like this, it means that your welding is applied exactly to the location that you are referring to with the arrowhead. Is it clear?
Yes, doctor.
Okay, now, if I give you something like this, same story, same shape, but I decided to, let me erase just that part that I created. It will take a little bit time, but no problem. Okay. What if I give you that shape? And instead of having the arrowhead heading upward, the triangular shape is heading upward, I'm going to put it this way. What does it mean?
Number two.
It's number A, number two, the opposite side of the arrow A. The arrowhead. Okay, number 2. What if I give you something like this?
Both,
yes, sir. Okay, what if I give you something like this? What does it mean? What is the difference between this case, guys, and that case there? Tell me, please.
I think we have a pitches and we have distance between them. We have more than one weld, so we have space between them.
So you mean for the first one, let me restate what you said, okay? For the first one, you mean that you have one continuous welding line.
Yes.
On the two sides. Do you agree?
Yes.
Okay. But when it comes to this one, this means that first of all, once I separated these two triangles, this means that you don't have continuous.
Yes.
You just have that same kind of like, if I erase that one, or let me use another color to exhibit the other case. This means that you have spots like this. And they are these spots has certain lengths. Of course, I have to tell you the number, like 60, 150, whatever. Okay, so the first number refers to the length of the welding, and the second number refers to the beach, the distance in between. But this is not only applied to that side, it should also be applied on the opposite side. So whatever took place in the first in the location number 1, it should also take place on the location number A, number 2, with the same dimensioning. Is it clear now, guys?
Yes.
Okay. Now let's get to the other types of welding. Remember that that table which has all these kinds of welding. So here is the time A to A to know about them. Again, guys, this is A, as I said, this is called welding simple examples. And this joint itself, the joint, the way you arrange the sheets, the welded sheets together, we call it butt location, B-U-T-T location. Okay. And if your welding is taking that shape, you see, guys, it's not the welding itself. It's the way you A, you finish up the sheets before you apply your welding. So you are not caring about the how the welding shape looks like. You are caring about how the sheet before welding will look like. So if you make your sheet as like in its inherent shape, يعني في الشكل الطبيعي بتاعه, then you will end up by having that A, that simple. Okay? And sometimes you come to the sheet before you make any welding and you make that chamfer. This chamfer here and chamfer there. And then you end up by having that A, that shape, which is V shape. Okay? What did we call it? We call it V shape or we call it what? Yes, V shape. Okay, guys? And now this one is a, what did we, I think we call this one bevel shape, and we call that one a W or double V. It's not here, by the way, but we can, actually this one, we used to call this one double V shape, okay? So as you can see, guys, it's not the case of the welding itself, it's the case of a, how you shape the ends of the a, of the sheets, before you make you apply your welding, okay? And these numbers, guys, they are not exact number, they are approximate number, okay? So you can claim that this the angle in between is not exactly, nobody can guarantee that this angle will be 60, even if you are talking about cutting the blade itself, because remember that there is something called the fits and the tolerance in our practical life. As an engineer, actually, especially the manufacturing engineer, there is no exact number. But there is something called the nominal number, which is the average. And this nominal number could increase or decrease by a little bit, some microns or millimeters. You get it? So usually these angles are average angles. And this actually theoretical, just to make your life as a theory or like in the theoretical application, to make your calculation very easy. Okay? Again, this kind of A of welding, as you can see, guys, you see this arrowhead, first of all, the symbol is referring to the location of the welding. And then this one is referring to A, to how the end of the A, because usually in a case like this, how can I do something like this? Usually I put that blade rested on the other blade and that's it. So we want to pay your attention in this case, that the end of that vertical shape, be careful, the end of that vertical shape is not a straight line, it's a V-shaped line, okay? And then again, he's telling you that on that side of that V-shape, which is supposed to be that side, you see that side, guys, there is a welding. And on the opposite side of the A, I mean on the opposite similar inclined end of the blade, there is also another welding, and so on. You keep moving like this. Okay, guys, is it clear now?
Doctor.
Okay, just to confirm on what we said. See, guys, sometimes I come to these joints, and instead of drawing like two-dimensional shape like this, I'm gonna draw just a line like this, and just put an arrowhead like this, and then put a bit like flipped over a U-shape. So what does it mean? It means that when you express it in a two-dimensional shape, it should be like this. Remember, because that shape is in the direction of the A, is in the area, in the neighborhood of the A, of the arrowhead. If it's in the neighborhood of the arrowhead, this means that it should be located where? On the same side, on the top surface. What is the difference between doing something like this, guys, which is consistent with the case up there, or doing something like this? Tell me, please, what is the difference between this case and that case?
The location.
The location, yes, which means that when you exhibit this one, it should be like this. You got it, guys? This
yes,
one, express that one, and this one express that one, and all of this consistent with what we agreed upon. Again, guys, I want to remind you about this one all the time. Remember this one, this is the basic. This arrowhead is where? No, no, just one moment, guys. Just one moment. There is something here completely opposite from what we said. Just one moment. Excuse me. This arrowhead is not in the neighborhood of the neighborhood of the arrowhead itself, which means that this triangular shape, this should be, according to our interpretation, it should be on the opposite side. Okay, let me go back to the symbol. I'm sorry, guys. Just one moment. One moment. One moment. Arrow side. Yes. This is arrow side. Filled in number of spots. Okay. This is arrow side. Okay, this is the opposite of the arrow side, so it should be on the same place. Now, if I get back to this one, again, if this one should be up there, the arrow side, okay. Okay, I think this is different from what we said before. See, this is the arrow side. And when he applied the welding, he applied the welding at the same location of the arrowhead itself, which means that if your triangular shape is not in the arrow side, this means that you have to put your welding at the location of the arrowhead itself. Okay, but if your shape was and I think this is what we said before, but if you have that case, this means that this triangular shape is in the neighborhood of the arrow side, this means that it should be applied inside. Okay, so for that case is okay because it's applied on both sides. Nothing wrong here. Okay, what about this one, guys? Just to make this one consistent with what we said before, you see the V shape is down there. It's on the arrow side, right?
Yes.
And then, what do you think? Should I put that lens here? If it's on the arrow side, this means no.
Yes.
Just
so the well is at the top, right? At the top of the two.
You know
plates.
What? I think this one to be right. Okay, let me see. This one, there is no problem with that one. This is the arrow side. If you put it this way, this means that you have to refer to the no. I think one moment, guys, because this is a little bit confusing here. I think whatever we said from the beginning, this is right. What we said at the beginning is right, but later I think we'll find some difficulty to put the arrowhead. Should we put the arrowhead like this, guys, to experience that situation or what?
Doctor, I think either way, since the symbol is at the bottom of the line, so whichever way the arrow points, the weld will be at that side, right?
You mean if I put the if this line represent the material itself before welding?
Yes.
This means that your arrowhead. Yeah, I mean that shape should be flipped over.
No. The weld will be towards the side of the arrow, right? So, in this case, the weld should be above, not below. Like the one you're drawing, I mean.
This welding is above the material itself as it's drawn there.
Yeah, this is correct. I think this is correct.
Yeah, but what about this one?
So in this case, the symbol on the arrow is below, right? So that means it's toward the arrow. So it's correct. The weld is towards the arrow. If it was above, it would be inside then, like how you said.
Okay. I see your point. See, the arrow is referring to that area.
Yes.
And this area could be the inside or outside.
Yes.
So as long,
yes.
Inside or outside. So as long as the triangular shape is heading downward, this means that it will be the lower one, right?
Yeah. Yes. Towards the arrow. Yes. Like closer to the arrow.
towards the arrow. This one towards the arrow, okay. And this one, let me see. This also towards the arrow, yes. So makes sense. This one guys towards the arrow because the arrow is referring to the top surface. Okay. What if I decided, guys? Yes, I agree with you. Thank you, Muhammad. Thank you for that, for helping me out. Again, guys, see this one, guys, your arrowhead is referring to that direction. Okay. And this direction could be the top or the bottom surface. You got it? So now, if this one, if the arrowhead is like this, this means that the arrow is originally referring to the A, referring to the top. You got my point? And in this case, your triangular shape is heading downward. This means that it will be on the opposite of the arrow. Am I right or wrong?
Yes.
What about the other people? Did you get this one, guys?
I got it, doctor.
Yes, doctor. So it's the... Yes,
so again, just to confirm on that, on what we said here. Okay, guys, if I put this one here like this, this has nothing to do with the top or bottom because it's coming from the top all the way to the bottom because this is just square shape, right? The only problem that we might face in this one or that one. So again, let's confirm, guys, on what Muhammad proposed. He said, okay, this is your A, this is your the base material, the material that you need to be welded together, okay? And then you put your arrowhead like this, and then you put your A, your shape like this. So once your shape is in the neighborhood of your arrow, this means that your whatever is there, it should be applied exactly to the location where you are, your arrow is referring to, which is supposed to be the top. You got it? So now, what if I need to use the same symbol, but like this? Like this. You see, this is your base material. You got my point here, guys?
Yes.
This is your base material. And this is your neighborhood of A, of arrow. Okay? As you can see, your shape is not in the neighborhood of the arrow, which means that it's supposed to be on the A. Am I right or wrong here?
No. I think, doctor, the valve will be towards the arrow still. Because the sign on the arrow itself is at the bottom, right? So the valve will be towards the arrow. At least what I got from the diagram they showed on the previous slide, I think.
Okay, let me see, guys. Let's get back to the diagram. Unfortunately, I skipped that diagram. I saw that. Okay, let's see. This is the original diagram, right?
This one, yes.
Okay, so again, where exactly this one is explained. Okay, let me erase everything. Other side.
So if it's at the top, it's at the other side of the arrow. If it's at the bottom, it's like towards the arrow side.
No, I didn't get it. Just one on Muhammad because finish symbol. Okay, I'm not caring about this. Root opening, filling. No, I'm not caring. Size, reference line. Okay. And then we have that a basic weld symbol. Yes. Both sides. Okay. So if we have the symbols, these are the location of the symbols, either both sides, like this case. Okay. And sometimes arrow side, it's supposed to be here. This is the side of the arrow itself. Okay. And then the other side of the A, other side of the arrow, right? Supposed to be up there. Okay, guys, you got this one? So this
yes.
one means it's in the arrow side. The welding is at the arrow side, okay? This one means the other side of the arrow. The other side of the arrow, I mean if there is like a surface like this, I mean by the other side of the arrow, I think this one, the opposite one, okay? And now your two sides, no problem with the two sides. The only problem is which side we are referring to. So if we take this one and apply it to that symbol, does it make sense?
Yes.
Yes, because this is the arrow side. Yeah, again, guys, see whatever is in the. No. See, when I say arrow side, it means arrow side because this is the side of the arrow. The arrow is going in this direction.
I think that means like if it's at the bottom, like the basic well symbol, if it's at the bottom of the arrow line, then the well will be where the arrow is pointing. And if it's on above the arrow line, then the well will be in the opposite side.
Okay, I don't want to get into the details of this one because this is not that important. The most important is the calculations, but it's important to understand, guys, before we leave. I'm sorry, guys. I'm going to stick to this one until we finished up. Again, this is the arrow. This is the arrow side. That side is the arrow side. Okay? So, according to this one, if your arrowhead is referring to the top, this means that this V shape is in the top. You agree?
Yes.
You agree? Okay, again here. If this one is like this, again, if you are referring to the top, then whenever I put you this one like this, this means that you wherever you are referring, you have to apply your welding, which is okay. So far is okay. Now, what if I did something like this? This means that your V shape, according to this explanation, according to this one, I think it's supposed to be like this. Am I right or wrong?
Yes. Correct.
This is the opposite. So makes sense, guys. Yes, sir. Thank you, Muhammad. But again, I am a little bit confused about that one because you see, this should be the arrow. If whatever we said is okay, then this triangular shape is not right. This should be up there. Am I right or wrong?
Doctor, I think the direction of the arrow doesn't matter. It's about the basic symbol, if it's above the line or below the line.
Yani it doesn't matter if your arrowhead is going up or going down there?
Yes. So if the basic symbol is below, then the well will be always on the side of the arrow, whether the arrow is up or below.
This is the only accepted interpretation. Yes, I agree with you guys. I agree with you, Muhammad. Thank you very much. So again, guys, when you say arrow side, it doesn't matter. Forget about the direction, if it's going up or down. You are just caring about this one. If it's below that reference line, this means that it will be at the location wherever you are referring by the arrowhead. Okay? And if this is on the opposite, I mean on the top, then it will be on the similar one, which similar location, but the opposite from what you are referring to. This is only accepted application interpretation. I'm sorry, guys. I'm gonna say it again. Sorry for that. It is all. Again, this one is on the top or at the bottom?
At the bottom.
This one at the bottom. If it's at the bottom, this means that wherever your arrow is referring, you have to apply your welding. Okay? What if I have this one like this? Forget about the arrow direction. If it's going up or down. This one is where, guys?
Up.
It's above the reference line. If it's above the reference line,
the opposite side of the arrow. Welding
should not be applied at whatever you are referring it to. It should be applied to the opposite. Is it clear now, guys?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you, Muhammad, for helping me out about this issue. Okay. Again, what about this one? Your arrowhead is referring here. I'm not caring about the arrowhead. I'm just caring about this one. This one is it means below the line means it wherever you are referring to, you should apply your welding, which makes sense. It should be on the top. Okay. So what if I did something like this? And I need to draw a two-dimensional shape similar to this one. This two-dimensional shape should be like this. If you agree, then I will get that everybody got the idea. Is it true exactly what I'm doing here? Is it right?
Yes.
Okay. Yes. So again, guys, below the line, forget about the arrowhead. Below the line means you apply the welding wherever your arrowhead is referring to. Above the line means you apply your welding to the opposite side of from wherever your arrowhead is referring to. Is it clear now?
Yes, Victor.
Okay. Same story here. See, if I give you something like this, and I put some symbol like this, okay, this means what? This is below the line. This means that it's exactly wherever your arrowhead is referring to, you have to apply your welding, which is exactly that location. Okay? So what about the other explanation? If I give you some corner like this, guys, if I give you some corner, but be careful, and I asked you to interpret whatever I draw up there. I'm gonna just remove that one. Okay, remove that one and just put one triangular shape at the top. What does it mean?
The well is on the opposite side, so inside the elbow.
Okay, but be careful, guys. Don't say okay. I'm gonna put the welding inside, and then you insist to put this the blades in that arrangement. You know why? Because practically speaking, this is not accepted. Although you are putting the welding here, but you are the connection between the two base material is very weak. So the only accepted interpretation for that one is not to draw that shape. You have to do something like this. You see what I'm doing, guys? You see the difference between the first case and the second case?
Yes.
So this one, although you locate your welding at the right location, but you still, from practically speaking, this is not accepted. So this one is not accepted, but this one is already accepted. Is it clear now, guys, or not clear?
Very clear, Doctor.
It is clear.
Okay. Now let's move on. Now it's time to speak about the stresses. Remember, guys, we started by explaining or interpretation of the symbols. Now it's time of our original business as a designer. Here, guys, it says it tells you that this is a V joint, V butt joint, okay? And he's telling you that there are some stresses acting on your mechanical member. Sometimes, guys, be careful. The failure in most of the cases, the failure does not take place in the welding and does not take place in the material away from the welding. Sometimes it takes place very close to that area. And that area, they call it, the manufacturer people, they call it HAZ. And the HAZ actually is the short of the three words: heat, affected, zone. Okay? In other words, as at the time you apply your welding, there is actually a drawback of that welding. There is an area actually between the welding and the remote original material. This area is get affected by the heat, and sometimes this area get more harder than the other material than the other location. And if the failure will take place, mostly the welding the failure will start from that area. So should we stand actually with cupped hand? No. The manufacturer people started thinking about the way of applying when they apply that welding, there should be some source of like cooling down and something like this and there are a lot of like research going on about that how to avoid that side effect of the welding. Anyway, this is not our business. Mainly our business here are like theoretical business. I'm going to assume that the failure will take place in the welding itself. And if the failure will take place in the welding itself, remember, guys, this is your original shape, which is we call it block shape. Okay, so you assume that your failure will take place along that line, and don't forget that this sheet has already a depth or length of L. Okay, so if we claim that this line has a height H, then I can claim that the cracked area or the stressed area or the normal stressed area has a rectangular shape, and that rectangular shape has that area, which is H times L. And then you end up by saying, okay, the very first stress analysis that you might think about in your welded area is that your welding might be subjected to a normal stress, and that normal stress is equal to F divided by the fractured area, which is H times L. Okay? sometimes in the welding actually they make that kind of a of that reinforcement. يعني ما بيسيبش ايه, they don't leave the welding to a to the level of the, no, they add some a some more. Okay, the problem in the static application, I mean if this welded part is not under repeated load, then that's fine, this is very very good. But actually when it comes to the like repeated load and the fluctuation and this plate will move up and down, then you will face a problem of stress concentration at that a at that area. So usually if your application is static, we leave it as it is. But if your application is dynamic, like subjected to fatigue loading and repeated loading, they prefer to come to this one and they using the cutting tool and remove that a that reinforcement part. Okay guys, so now this is the first a mode of the a of the stress. The second mode of the stress, in case you remember in the first mode guys, your force is directly a perpendicular to the a to the cracked area. In the second application, as you can see here guys, your force is parallel to the a to the fractured area. So in this case, instead of having a sigma, you'll end up by having tau, and this tau is equal to f over the h times l. Okay, assuming guys, assuming what? Assuming that these two bars, the bead down there and the reinforcement up there, are a neglected. Otherwise, the total fractured area or the total stressed area should include everything, include the a, the, that curvature at the top and the small curvature at the a at the bottom. So usually we are saying what? Pay attention to the a words used. It's called, we call it a average. Okay. So the average shear stress in this case would be F divided by H over L. Okay. What about this application, which is very common? In this application, if you remember guys, this is some kind of a overlap. Remember when I told you at the beginning of the class that some of the application, you bring in the two ends of your sheet, and then instead of applying the welding directly, you make reinforcement sheet on the top and another reinforcement sheet at the bottom. Remember this one? And then you make your welding here and there and here and there. Okay, here is exactly what we are studying right now. Transverse fillet A welding. Transverse fillet welding. Okay. And this, as you can see, guys, although your sheets, I mean the two supporting sheet on the top and the original sheet at the middle, they are all subjected to normal force, but at the end your welding itself will fail by shear along that direction. So again, guys, in this kind of air connections, usually the applied load is just regular normal load to the A, to the perpendicular side area of your A of your sheet. But when it comes to the true situation and where the failure will take place, we discovered by inspection and by experiments that this failure will take place along that plane, okay, which is making an angle theta. And in the next slide, I'm going to tell you what is that theta. But as you can see, guys, this shape is very similar to what? Remember to that stress element that have sigma x and sigma y two-dimensional and tau x y, and then I told you what if I need to calculate the stresses, the normal stress and the shear stress along a plane making a theta angle. Remember from where we measure the theta angle? Remember this story about the stress analysis or the stress element? Same story here, guys. When you speak about the welding, you take that vertical line as your reference, okay, and then you move along a anti-clockwise direction to locate the a to locate the plane at which the fracture will take a will take place. Now if with some analytical manipulation, you will end up by having these relations. Your shear force, which is called F sub s here in that a, your shear force, again guys, where is my shear force? The force along that direction is related to the normal applied force through this relation. F shear is equal to F sine theta. What about the F normal? Again, what is F normal? It is applied perpendicular to that A fractured area. And this F normal, as you can see, it is related with F through multiplying A F by cosine theta. Okay. Now, if you look at this triangular shape, and there are two rule, more than rule to apply to the triangle, guys. One of the very famous one is cosine rule. Remember, if you need to calculate that length, you said this one square is equal to that one square plus that one square minus two times the two lenses cosine the angle in between. This is called the cosine rule. There is another rule which is called the sine rule. Sine rule, which means you come to each length in your triangle and you divide by the opposite A, opposite angle. So when we found that this length is called T, which again T refers to the A, the welded throat, and you know what's called throat from the beginning of the class, okay? So you end up by having that relation. T of divided by sine 45. Why sine 45? Because from the very first moment, I know that this one is asymmetric, and this angle is 45. So you end up by having this relation. T over sine 45 is equal to H divided by the opposite area. This is your H, opposite angle. So this is your H, and this is your opposite A angle. So your opposite angle, as you can see, guys, this angle with theta, this angle was 45. Then you end up by the opposite angle will be 180, which is the summation of the A inside angles of any triangle, minus 45 minus theta. And then you will end up by having that A, that relation. This is the third side, square root of H divided by cosine sine A sine theta. What I need to have, guys, here in this picture is only this A, is only that relation between T and H. Then you will end up by having this relation. Your throat, in this kind of applications, length is equal to H divided by cosine theta plus sine A plus sine theta, okay? Now, guys, let me remind you about something. What if I put theta 45? What will be the sine and the cosine?
The same.
If you repeat that theta was 45, then you will end up with A.
2 sine, 2 cosine.
You will end up by this 2H square root H divided by 2. Am I right or wrong?
H over root.
Yes.
Okay. And then you can take this one with the T, and then you'll end up with square root of 2. Square root of 2, which is what? 1.414. Am I right or wrong?
Yes.
Okay. And then you'll end up by having the reciprocal, which is A. You'll end up by that relation, which is 0.707. H, remember this one at the beginning, I speak about that relation, guys. Anyway, without getting into all this details, you will end up by having this A, these two stresses. Remember, guys, we are studying the stress along that direction because of the effect of the F shear, and on the same plane we are also studying the A, the normal stress. Then you will end up by having tau equal to F shear divided by that area, and again, guys, I have to remind you that this area is equal to H times A, H times L, but this is not H, this is T, okay? And remember, your T is equal to H divided by cosine theta plus sine A sine theta. So if you need H by itself, then you're telling me my H is equal to T times cosine theta plus sine theta, okay? What if I multiply this one by the total length of the blades? Here is the blades. And you know this A, this is the fractured area of your weld. You imagine what I'm doing, guys, now? Then you have to multiply this one by A, by L, okay? So you'll end up by multiplying A, T times L. And again, T times L, if you substitute here this one, you will end up by having this tau. This tau is equal to the total acting force F, this is the actual force, times sine theta, cosine theta, plus sine theta over HL. What about sigma? Your sigma is equal to A. Again, this F times cosine theta, you know the whole story. Now, if I asked you about this one, remember that one, guys, from the last lecture? If I told you, please tell me what is the von Mises angle, von Mises stress at the angle. What is the von Mises? Can somebody remind me what is that von Mises? Is it related to one of the theories, which theories of failure, guys? Von Mises. I know that almost like half of the class was absent, but at least you listen to the recording before you come to that class.
Yes, doctor.
What's sigma prime, von Mises stress, remember?
Yes.
Okay, it's coming from originally from which exact theory of failure? How many theories of failure we studied, guys, last week?
Three, the normal and the shear and the distortion energy.
Distortion energy, Allah ينور عليك. So now you remember, guys, this distortion energy theory has almost six names. One of the names of that theory is von Mises theory. And there is a relation between sigma prime and your sigma x and your sigma y and your tau xy.
Yes.
And as you can see, guys, in that picture, according to the orientation, this is if I call this one x and I call this one y, I can claim that my sigma x is not there. There is no normal stress in the x direction. You see, this is your x. But there is normal stress in the y direction, which we call it sigma y. And there is a direct shear in the tau x y direction. Then you will end up by what? Your sigma y here is already represented by that sigma. You agree? And your tau xy here is already represented by that A, by that tau up there. And then you will end up by having this A very simplified form about your A, the relation between sigma prime and your sigma and your tau along that direction, which is making angle A, angle theta. The issue is here, guys, when you design, usually you design for the maximum sigma prime. How can I get the value of the maximum sigma prime here, guys, out of this picture? How can I get the maximum sigma prime? How can I get the maximum von Mises value?
D sigma by d theta is zero.
Allah ينور عليك. You take the derivative of that sigma prime with respect to theta, and then you end up by finding the value of theta. Okay? Usually you have two values, value which give you the max, and the other value which will give you the A, the min. And this is exactly what we did. We ended up by having a largest von Mises. Okay, just one moment. Okay, have this one somewhere else. Okay, guys, largest von Mises, sigma prime, largest von Mises value will take place when your theta is equal to how much, guys? 62.8. 62.5. You got it? Again, your maximum von Mises is taking place at an angle at a plane, making an angle 62.5 a degree. This 62.5 degree is measured from that vertical direction. Now, what is the maximum shear stress? Remember, guys, we have two theories. We have theory of distortion energy theory, and we have maximum shear stress theory. So I'm looking also for maximum shear stress. How can I get the maximum shear stress? Very simple. You go back to the shear stress, the general shear stress. This is tau at an angle theta. If I need to calculate the maximum tau, all what I need to do is just take this one, take the derivative, and make it equal to zero, and you end up by calculating the theta at which maximum shear will take place. And here is your result. At theta equal to 67.5, your maximum shear stress is taking place. Okay? And when you calculate your maximum shear stress, you will end up by having this relation. Your tau max is equal to 1.207 F over HA, F over HL. Okay, guys. Let me ask you a question. According to our study for the theories of failure, which one is more conservative? Which one I can trust more to when I use it for coming up with any design?
Maximum shear stress.
Exactly. The maximum shear stress theory, I can trust it more in the application of A, where I mean to be more conservative, actually. But in most, actually, on the opposite of that side, you see that in the people of welding, they are not caring about the maximum shear stress. They are caring about using the von Mises. Why? Because they know that this welding is not exactly at this exact point. It will spread it out on the all over the sheet. So although the theory itself is not conservative like the maximum shear, but from the other point of view, he's saying it's okay. It's not safe at this exact location, but your welding is still is not happening at this exact location. It's taking place along along a very long line or very long circle. You get it? So usually they adopt that a the von Mises theory. And remember, guys, we did not say that that von Mises theory is not accepted at all. We said it's a it's it has a reliability of how much? Do you remember the reliability on using it? Eh?
50.
Yes, sir. 50%. Okay. And the reason for have that reliability of 50%, if you represent the normal stress distortion energy theory, maximum distortion energy theory, this is the theoretical line, and then you found that your practical a your practical failure. The specimen which is practically failed under the practical load is spread like this. So as you can see, almost half of the samples or half of the products have failed on that side, while the other half have failed on the opposite side. This is why we say that this theory could be accepted, but with a reliability of 50%. Anyway, I'm not going to take you back to the to that theory. You need to study it very well, because this is almost like the backbone of any design. Remember, guys, the theories of failure is the backbone of any design, either machine design one or machine design two, or any of the machine design that you will face in your life as a mechanical designer. Okay. Now, what about this stress distribution? Actually, this stress distribution is the actual stress at the different location of the A of your joint. Remember, guys. Look at these points A, B, C. These points are exactly located here. If you go to the original shape, here is your original shape. This is my point A, and this is my point B, and this is my point A, C. So when you make the distribution, practically speaking, when they measure the stresses at this location, they find that very complicated shape. They found that the normal stress distribution along that vertical line is taking that shape, while the shear stress along that vertical line is taking that shape. On the opposite side, they found that at that base, this is a distribution of the normal stress, regular normal stress, and this is the distribution of the shear stress. Okay, but they don't have any expectation about how the failure line will look like. Okay, and then they ended up by having based on this relation or that relation, they ended up by having a sigma 1 and sigma 2 on that picture. So the conclusion, guys, that whatever you have here from your experimental, from your theoretical derivation, does not exactly or fully describe what is going on in the practical application, because in the practical application the stresses are very complicated. So what should we do, guys, to guarantee that our theoretical form or our analytical form can give very close results to the experimental application? The only way to guarantee this, guys, is to by raising up your design factor, or factor of safety. Okay, and this factor of safety actually is not coming up is not made up by me or you as an academic. No, it is made up by people which have a very long and they are very, very, very old in the field of welding. So out of their experiment, out of their experience, and out of the experiments that they used to do, and out of their the notes that they are recording about the history of failures in welding, they come up with some recommended value for the factor of safety. Okay, guys. Anyway. Now, remember that so far we have no analytical approach accurately predict the experimental measured stresses. Okay? And so far we said we have sigma prime and we have tau A, we have tau max. Okay? What if I said that your failure, just to make my life easy, I decided to say that my failure will take a place along that plane, which when your theta is equal to 45. Remember, guys, when we substituted the theta equal to 45, what happened? We ended up by this relation, that your tau is equal to the force, and the area, if you remember that number, is equal to 0.707 H times L. If you take the reciprocal, then you will end up by having your tau is equal to 1.414 F divided by HL. Be careful, guys. As I mentioned, This form, I just picked it up just to make my life easy. I just assumed instead of saying that the failure will take place at angle 67.5 and then make my life complicated. No, I just make it short. I said, so, okay, I'm going to consider that angle equal to A, equal to 45. Okay, so let's see what's happened. When you assumed that your angle equal to 45, we ended up by having tau max equal to 1.414. Am I right or wrong? F divided by HL. Am I right or wrong, guys, about this one?
Yes, doctor. Right.
I said theta equal, just to make my life easy, I just make it very famous number, which is 45. When this number, by the way, it's very famous in the A, in the theories of failure. We found that most of the A of the shear failure is taking place at that direction, 45. We ended up by having one tau max equal to 1.414. But what about the exact analytical tau max that you already got from your calculation? My exact the analytical tau max was equal to 1.207 F divided by A by HL. Okay, so let me tell you something. Which one you trust more if you're gonna use? The first one, which is by which you make your life easy, or the second one, which is, was very complicated to A to reach that form after making derivative and all this stuff. Which one you trust more?
The second, doctor.
Are you sure, man?
No, I'm not, but I think because it's an exact location of theta.
No, forget about the exact and the not exact. I'm blindly speaking. If I told you, which one will give you more conservative result? If you claim that your tau max is equal to this number, or you claim that your tau max is equal to that number?
414, because you're basing your calculation, you're designing based on the maximum stress, not the lower one.
No, Reza, in both cases, you are this form based on the maximum, but this maximum from the A welding point of view. This is the tau max from the pure analytical welding point of view. Then you end up by tau max equal to that number. And you end up that this should be the exact angle of the A of that plane of tau max. But if I'm speaking from just a pure material point of view, if you remember, most of the theories is telling you that your tau max will take place at angle equal to 45. And then you decide to substitute that 45, and then you ended up by having that tau max. So the end of the story, guys, which one is more conservative? To adopt the one which is telling me that your tau max is 1.4 F, forget about this the remaining part of that fraction. Or to trust that one who is telling me that your tau max is just 1.2 of that F.
The first one,
which one is making augmentation? مين اللي بيضخم الموضوع? Which form is making augmentation for your force, is making your force bigger than it should be?
Yes, yes, yes. I got your point.
Which one?
The first one.
First one, Allah ينور عليك. Is it clear, guys?
Yes, doctor.
This point is clear? So again, guys, if I'm telling you that it's okay, I'm gonna design that mechanical part, assuming that you have a force equal to 1,000 newton, and then you bring two designers. The first designer asks you for your load. You said 1,000 newton, which will be the same answer for the same question if you have been asked that question from the other designer. When the other designer went for his design, he decided to multiply 1,000 by 5. While the second designer, he decided to multiply the same number by 7. Which one you trust more? The one which he based his design on 5 times your actual load, or the one who based his design on 7 times your actual load?
The 7 times.
The 7.
Of course, the 7. And this is the end of the story. Which one I trust more? I trust more this one more than that one. But this does not mean that this one will give you unsafe results. No, it gives me unsafe results, but this one is more conservative. You got it?
Yes.
So in comparison between the pure analytical, tau max from the welding point of view and tau max from the material and theories of failure point of view, we ended up by having this relation. You will divide the tau max, which is coming from just very simple theory of failure, and that tau max, which is coming very complicated analytical analysis to the welded area, and then we ended up by what's called inflating rate. Inflating a factor. Inflating a factor, يعني معامل التضخيم. فلقينا, we found that, you know what inflating a factor, Muhammad Taha, right?
I'm not sure, doctor.
Inflating means augmentation factor. See, this is your original value, 1.207. This is your tau max from the welding. And the other tau max from the very simple theory of failure is 1.414. As I said, I trust this one more. So if I'm telling you what will be the inflation coefficient between the tau max from the theory of failure and the complicated analytical tau max of the welding, of the welded part, then you'll end up by dividing 1.414 by 1207. You got the point, guys, here? Is it clear here?
Yes, yes.
So this means that the simple tau max is 1.17 time of the A of the complicated tau max, and still I can trust it more. Is it clear now, guys, this point?
Yes, this is different from the safety factor, right?
It's similar. See, it's similar to the safety factor. It's similar to the safety factor, but I cannot say that it's explicitly the safety factor.
Okay.
Now, guys, let's come to this kind of welding. This is another type of welding. You see, guys, the difference between this case and the case before is the direction of the force itself. You see, you have two F acting in this direction, and this two F is divided by two reactions on the lower two blades. Then you'll end up by having a shear. Also, actually, this shear also will take place along that direction. You see this area? The area that I'm coloring with the blue color? This will be the sheared area. So if you look at this sheared area from the side, you'll end up by having that crack here, guys. I'm sorry. This will be your side of your A, of your sheared area. And then you'll end up by having this tau, which is equal to a 1.414F over HL, which is the same like tau A, tau max that we spoke about before. Okay. Now, how can we deal with the welding problem? Or in other words, how can we solve a welding problem and choose the best height for that welding such that to be safe? Now, if I'm telling you guys that this is your A, your blade, and from the very first moment, I'm asking you to build that blade A, to weld that blade to the A, to the other blade, or to the back blade. There are different options. Either you tell me I'm going to put welding from that side only, or I'm going to put welding from these two sides, or I'm going to put welding as a C shape, or I'm going to put welding on the whole circumference. So you make this C shape on the top, and this make this one on the back. You understand what I'm saying, guys?
Yes, doctor.
So these are the all options of applying your welding. But actually, what is my business as a designer? Your business as a designer is not to choose the shape of welding. This is decided by another technician or by another design of engineer. So what is my business as a designer? My business as a designer is to tell him how much is the height of that welding such that it will be safe and it will be able to carry that load. You got it, guys? You understand what I'm saying? Your business is not to decide how the whole welded area will look like. This is not your business. This is a business of the head of the designers. But you, as a specialist in the welded areas design, your main business is to tell me only what is the height, what is the maximum depth, Okay. Oh, sorry. What is the minimum depth of that welded material to be safe against carrying the applied load? Okay, guys. Here is the story. How we solve that problem? First of all, you look at the force, and then you bring up what's called centroid of your welding. How can I get the centroid of your welding? Some of the welding is very easy to get the centroid for, like this one. You have a welding from the top, and you have a welding from the bottom, and they are both of course equal. So if I told you where is the centroid, of course you will tell me that the centroid is located at the middle here. You all agree about this, right, guys? What I give you this welded area like this. Okay, now you will tell me what will be the centroid. I'm gonna tell you it's okay. You have to tell me what is that length? Okay, what is that length? And if you remember this practice problem that I gave you at the very first time, when I asked you to calculate the second moment of area for different shapes, before thinking about having I, you have to look at the neutral A axis. And the two neutral axes for that shape will intersect at a point which is also the centroid of our welding. You got my point, guys?
Yes, sir.
The very first step is to look for the centroid. The second step is to move your force virtually from its point of application to that centroid. And as usual, when you move any force, it should be accompanied with a torque. Some people might do this action. They say it's okay. This is the direction of the force. This is the force after virtual transfer, and this is the torque. And some of the people might look at it from a balance point of view. They said it's okay. If this is your force, then I have to apply another force there to make couple. Because if you apply this force here, you still need to satisfy the summation of force equal to zero after removing that one. So you think about it this way. Okay, I'm having that force. Okay. But still there is an opposite force to guarantee that there is a equilibrium. And then you look at this one and that one, and you see that these two forces are making a couple in the clockwise direction. So you end up by having an equilibrium or balancing a couple in the opposite direction. So again, guys, some of the people might deal with the situation like this. Here is your force. Here is the point. In a very simple word, you'll end up by having this one like this. And you forget about the original force. Okay? Some of the people say, no, I'm going to deal with it. And I prefer the second one, actually, to be honest with you. This is the original location of application of your force. And this is the point to which you should move your force virtually. Then you will end up by having your original force and the torque which was done by that which was accompanying that force in moving from the first location to the second location. You got the point, guys? It doesn't matter. The only difference here in this, either in that case, in this case or that case, is only the directions. But you still have the same force, either this one or that one. Am I right? And you still have the same moment or the same torque, because still the arm is the length is the same. Anyway, so this is the second step. First step is to locate your centroid. Second step is to locate is to move the force from its original point of application to the centroid, accompanied by a moment or a torque. How can I say torque or moment here, guys?
Torque, because the force is trying to break the welding material.
Okay, in all cases, forces is trying to break the welded material, but this is not the answer. This should not be the answer, man. Remember, when I give you something like this, this is almost every time, guys, we are repeating this. If I told you that there is a force here acting at that end, and then I need to study the effect of the force on that cross section at the back. You will tell me it's okay. This force is making a direct shear, which in most of the cases are neglected. And then when I move the force along that direction, I ended up by having a moment in that plane. What is the relation between this plane and the cross-sectional area, they are both perpendicular. And then you will end up by naming this one M, not T. But in another scenario, if you have something like this, okay. By the way, guys, alhamdulillah that we raised up that this point. In the last problem in the assignment, when I ask you for like having a maximum shear or maximum normal stress or whatever, you have to be careful not to draw only the stress element. No, before drawing the stress element, there are two important steps. The first step is to show me your force analysis, and then you show me where is that stress will be located as a point, and then you imagine that you make zoom in for that point, and then you end up by having that a sigma x and sigma y and sigma t. But most of you, almost like 90% of you guys, he's not caring about all this. He's just, it's okay, I have sigma x, and maybe sigma y in this case is zero, and tau x y is zero. Okay, that's fine, but where this one is exactly located? If you remember, guys, in the quiz, when I put a question related to the stress element, I was very clear to cut it down into a steps or stations. First of all, I asked you to locate the location of that maximum stress. Second, I asked you to draw that a stress element. You know why I did that? I should not do this. If you understand, if you are a good student and understand what do I mean by making that kind of stress analysis, you should do all these steps without asking you to do it. You have to make your force analysis, and then you go from force analysis and you refer to the location of the worst area. And then at that location of the worst area, decide to take a point, and then this point is zoomed up, zoomed in to become that square shape, what we call it stress element. You have to do this by default, guys, if you are a designer. But to take me directly from the statement of the problem directly to draw that stress element, this is not accepted. So be careful, guys. Be careful, okay? Anyway, getting back to our question, if I have force like this, when I move it for the first time to that direction, I was moving along that direction. And then I ended up by a plane of that A of that couple. I'm not going to call it M or T. Based on whatever, on the cross section that you are willing to study, which is supposed to be that one, at this exact moment, should I call it M or T? T. Because your plane is parallel to the cross sectional area. So be careful, guys, from all of this. But here is the surprise, guys. In that one, he said it's okay. I forget about this one. I'm going to tell you how he calculated. But if you can notice that for the second stress, he said I have M times R, which is not accepted at all, even if it's written in a textbook. So please, guys, whenever you see this M in that textbook, just please cross it out and put T. Why? You all agree that this is the monitor plane is the plane of the A of the couple, of that couple. You agree, guys? Do you agree that when you move that force from that original location to the centroid, you ended up by having the monitor plane itself, or the paper, if you have a printout, the paper plane is the plane of the couple? Do you agree or you don't agree?
Yes, okay.
Yes, definitely.
So now, imagine, guys, that I'm comparing that plane with the expected area. Actually, what will happen if you look from that side, the expected area of fracture, if I'm looking from that side view, guys, imagine that this is your side view of the blade. Here is the end of the welding, and here is the blade. You see what I'm doing, guys? I'm trying to represent, make it 3D so you can understand what is going on here in that picture. And this is a back blade on which you make your welding. You apply your welding. And here is the location of your force. I'm sorry for this. If in my hand, I would use another color. But anyway, you see, guys, this one is the location of your force. And this is your blade. Okay, and this is your welding. If you are speaking the exactly about the line of fracture, this line of fracture, remember guys, the angle theta, the angle theta was measured from here, and this angle was almost equal to 67. Remember that number, the exact number, 67.5. And then we decided to make it 45 to make my life easy. So now, if I'm looking at that fracture line from that side, then you will end up by having this area, which is neither perpendicular, I mean, in that, which is neither perpendicular to the plane of the monitor, nor parallel to the plane of the monitor. It's 45 in between. صح ولا أنا غلطان?
Yes.
Right. Okay. Now, how can we deal with this? The only way to make your life easy is to imagine that this area, guys, is rotated in this direction until it becomes the area that the projected area that you can see with the pink color. In another words, the true area, guys, is not that area. The true area of failure or the true area of having a shear is not that pink colored area. It should make some certain angle. And then we decided, just to make our life easy, we decided to let this area rotate 45 degree until it becomes in the same plane of the original A, of the back plane. And in this case, you'll end up by having this area, the pink area, as your true area. It's not true, between quotations, as your true area of shearing. So now, if you compare that that pink area of shearing with the plane of the application of the torque itself, sorry, the moment, the couple itself, then you have to call this one M or T. Please tell me.
T, doctor.
T, Allah ينور عليه. This is why I will never accept, even if it's coming from a textbook, I will never accept this one to be called M. It should be called what? T. Because actually there is another location that I'm going to show you later, inshallah, that already has M, not T. But for this clear, crystal clear case, it's T, not M. Anyway, so now it's clear, guys, that what we did at the beginning, we moved out, we started by A, locating the centroid. And then we move that force to the centroid. When I move that force to the centroid, it was accompanied with a T. Now, what is the business of the F itself? F by itself is making a shearing direct shear force. And this direct shear force is equal to V over area. Somebody might ask me, what is V? Actually, V is exactly equal to your A, to your F value. Okay? Again, this direct shear will have a which direction? It should take the same direction as the force, which means if you come to any point here, guys, for example, he decided to choose that point. Then he said, it's okay, I have a shear which is coming directly from that force, and I decided to call it, this is some kind of agreement between us, okay? In the real situation, it's not like this. The picture is more complicated than this. So in the real, we decided to come up with this agreement. Whatever will come from the directly from the force F or V, I'm going to call it tau prime. And this tau prime, we call it primary shear. How is the direction of that primary shear? It should take the same direction of the A of the force. In other words, guys, let's assume that you have a force making that angle. This is the direction of the force. And then you bring your centroid, and then you draw a perpendicular line to the centroid to be able to draw that force. So now your force is causing what? Tau primary. This tau primary is equal to V, again, V over area, the total F, this same force, which is V, divided by area. But what about the direction? When I put it at any location, you have your direction for your tau primary should be exactly the same direction as your F, which means in this case, you will change that line, you will cross out that line, and you draw another line making the direction of A, taking the same direction of F. Is it clear now, guys?
Yes.
So this is the first. So this is the first force, first shear, which is called primary shear, and the second shear, which is called secondary shear, which is equal to M. No, it's not M. It's T times R. What is R, guys? R is the distance between the centroid and the point that you decided to study, because some other guys might study this point. And in this case, you still have tau primary here. And this is your new R. And as you can see, guys, your tau primary, tau secondary, which has double prime up there, your tau secondary should always be perpendicular to that R. So based on this reality, when I put tau secondary here or tau double prime here, should I put it in this direction or should I put it in the opposite direction to be very similar or consistent to what was what we did before? As you can see, guys, these two tau prime tau secondaries are both equal perpendicular to the R, but the problem is, should I put it in the direction of rotation of tau or the opposite of tau? Here is the end of the story. Some of the textbook, they might put it at the opposite direction of tau. Yani if your torque is acting in that direction, then they prefer to put it in the rotating anti-clockwise. But as you can see in that textbook, they are insisting to put it in the same direction, assuming that this is your torque, okay? Then you'll end up by having this tau double prime in the same direction of A, of that torque. You got it, guys? So based on this, this one is accepted as my tau double prime, but this one is not accepted as my tau double A, double prime. Now, what is after that? Recall, guys, that we are very close to the final solution. Why? You already have tau is equal to F. F is already given, divided by area. Remember that area was equal to what? This area was equal to what, guys? 0.707H, which is the unknown that you are looking for, times A, times L. Okay? And what is L here? L should be the length of that side plus the length, the total length of the welding, not only this one. Okay? It should be the total length. I mean this one and that one. Now, what about this one? Tau double prime is equal to torque. Of course, we already calculated the torque, which is F times the total length. I mean that perpendicular length from here to there. Okay. Times R. What is R here in this case? As you can see, this is your R. It could be measured directly from the A, or you can make some calculation, analytical calculations, divided by J. And here is the story. How can I find the J for the welding? Don't worry, guys. There are very ready to go tables in your textbook. You seek for the case which is very similar to your A, to your case. You see, guys, I almost have six shapes here. This one is not, this one is not, this one is not, this one is not, this one is not. The only one which is A accepted to be similar to my case is that one. Although my two lines are horizontally parallel and these two are two vertically parallel, but you still can go around and you can calculate the JU. The only difference here, guys, in that JU and the one that you have is to replace D with B. Yani if in my case, I'm gonna say, okay, this is JU, and you here, guys, you refer to unit lengths, okay? JU refers to the unit length. So what is the relation between J and JU? Very simple. The only difference is that your J is equal to 0.707H times JU. Remember this relation, guys. Your JU, which is coming from the table, unit molar moment of inertia, is related to the total moment, molar moment of inertia, by just multiplying by this number. 0.707H, and again, guys, you can see that H shows up again in that form. Anyway, how can I use that form for the two perpendicular line and make it match with my JU for the two horizontal line? Just very simple. I'm gonna replace HD with B and HB with D. So this one will be B times 3D square plus B square. You see what I'm doing, guys? Divided yes. by 6. And now I'm going to tell myself, what is B? B in your case, B in your case, it should be the distance of what? Between the two A, between the two lines of the welding. And D is the length of the welding itself. You got my point?
Doctor, why you replace B and D?
Because actually your original shape is like this. Your welded shape is like this. While the one available in that table is two vertical line, and I'm not dealing with vertical, I'm dealing with two horizontal line. Is it clear or not clear?
Okay. Doctor,
Like you are rotating, you are rotating this line with 90 degree. Then in this case, B will replace D and D will replace B. Okay. Again, just to get satisfied, guys, go to the table, because the table does not have only this case. The table also have that case. But this is just examples from a big table there in the textbook. Okay. So in the table, you can find this case easily. And please compare it with whatever I said right now. Maybe I did a mistake. But I'm almost sure that this is what you should be there. Okay.
Doctor, the distance D is supposed to be the neutral axis of the
building. No, see, there in the picture. Look at this one. He's telling you that, for example, area is based on H times. You know what H? H is the unknown that you are looking for. But what is D? Here it's clear that my D is the length of the welding itself. In the second picture, here he's telling you that your J is equal to D times B square plus D square. What is D? Here you go. The D is the length of the weld. And what is B? B actually is the distance between the two A welded sides. That's it.
Okay, doctor, can you assume any numbers in the diagram and just apply? I just want to make sure.
See, just for example.
Okay.
Just one moment. Let's assume in that case I give you that length equal to 120 millimeter, and the length from here to there, the distance from here to there is like, let's say, 110 millimeter. خلاص. Now, according to the table. The table is calling the word, the length of the welding, he's calling D. So in that case, this should be your D. While the distance in between, he called B. Now, if I take this one, these two symbols, and make comparison with whatever I have in the real situation, then you'll end up that your D here in that case is 120, and your B in that case is 110. You got it or not yet?
Okay.
And what you need to do is just a very simple substitution. You bring your D, which is 120, plug it into this equation. You bring your B, which is 110, and then you end up by having some value for the JU. But be careful, this JU is per unit length, which means that whatever you'll get from here, it will be in terms of millimeter cubed. Remember that your total G should be in millimeter A to the fourth. So what you need to do is just to take that JU from the table and you multiply it by 0.707H. As you can see, this is the dimension of units of millimeter or meter. Then you will end up by having your J in terms of millimeter to the power 4. Is it clear now?
Okay. So, Dr. Besson, no, that the height of welding doesn't make any difference, the calculation?
No, the height of welding is there. It's in your equation. See, it's everywhere. It's here in the value of H area. It's here also in the value of A. No, it shows up only on the area, and it shows up in the value of J, not JU, because as I told you, the JU is like you divide by that H, so you remove it. You understand what I'm saying? No feedback. Okay, as usual. Now, guys, I'm going to take you back to this one. Your tau prime is equal to the force, which is V, divided by area. How can I get the area? Again, very simple. I'm going to get back to the table. Here is the table, guys. Remove all. This is the welding, which is similar to my case. How can I get the area? It's telling you exactly that your area is equal to 1.414. times H times what? D. Now I'm gonna get back to my case here. I'm gonna put 1.414 times H. What is D in our case, guys? Assuming that this number is already given, what's your D? 120. Is it clear?
Yes.
So now you have the value of J tau prime. And on the other side, you need to calculate your tau double prime, which is equal to m. M is equal to, not m, of course, I said t. T is equal to f times a, the total length, what's supposed to be that length, this here, from here to there, times r. What is r? I have to measure it from the a, or calculate it by analytical a, calculations from the graph. So your r is there. Divided by j, how can I get j? Remember, you go to the table, you bring sub j sub u, and then you divide, you multiply it by 0.707h. Remember that? This number, this one is already number. 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 Then you'll end up that your tau prime is some constant divided by h, and your tau double prime is again another constant, let's call it constant star, divided by the same h. Am I right or wrong, guys?
Right, Doctor.
Now, you end up by having these two tau prime and tau double prime. This tau prime is referring downwards. Your tau double prime is referring in that direction. Of course, based on the geometry, you'll be able to find the angle in between. And if I told you guys, I'm not looking for tau prime or tau double prime, I'm looking for the resultant. Then remember how to get the resultant for a case like this? Do you remember how, to, if from the vector analysis, if you have F1 and you have F2 like this, remember how to get the total F? Graphically, I can draw that line and complete our A, that shape, and then you end up by having the total F. And if you remember, this total F is equal to what?
Square root
F1 square plus F2 square. Remember, guys, plus 2F1 F2 cosine the angle in between. Let's call this angle psi. This angle, guys, this one, this total angle. Okay? This is psi. Same story. I can tell you that my total tau is equal to tau prime square plus tau double prime square plus 2 tau prime tau double prime cosine the angle in between. Remember that this A, this was something over H, and this was something over H, and remember that we have a square root, the square, and this is something over H, something over H. Your psi could be measured directly from the figure, or could be calculated analytically. Then you'll end up by your tau is equal to 1 over h. You grab it out of the a square root, and then you'll end up by a square root of some numbers here, right? And then you end up by having your tau as a total is equal to some constant, let's call it constant 1 or whatever, divided by a by h. Now you go to the table, the welding table, and you choose that your tau should be actually less than or equal to the given tau allowable for your A, for your welding to survive with A under that A, under the application of that load. And then your tau allowable is a number. And remember, for the safe design, your tau should be, which is supposed to be your tau max, assuming that this is the point at which tau max is taking place. Okay? Your tau max is equal to some constant, tau allowable. And the tau max itself was equal to constant divided by A by H. Then you end up by having A, by having H value. Let's say, guys, after you have your H, that you ended up by having this H 2.1 or whatever any number. And I asked you to give me round the figure for that H. And let's assume that the standard H in the market, after, of course, you apply your welding, will be something like this. It will be 1, it will be 4, it will be 6, okay? Or let's say 2, 4, 6. I'm not saying that this is exact number. I'm just giving you an example, guys, okay? So this is 2, 4, 6, and then 8. Then I'm asking you, what will be the safest weld size, okay, to be applied here such that this connection will A will survive or will afford the applied force? What's your answer, guys, should be?
4, Doctor.
4. Who is speaking?
هادي حربي.
خالد, you said for خالد. Anybody else guys agree with خالد or disagree with him?
I agree too.
You agree too, Rida agrees. Who else agree with him guys? Abdullah al-Miskin. خالد القاسم. حسين. Nobody there? Okay. Okay, Muhammad Taha, do you agree?
I'm not sure, doctor.
See, I'm telling you that your calculation, you ended up your calculation by having H equal to that number, 2.1 millimeter. And these are the standards of the welding in the market. Either two, the size should be two, H should be two, or four, or six, or eight. So your answer should be, your H should be approximated to become two, or it should be approximated to become four.
Four.
See guys, if you are talking, again, remember that there are two things that I keep telling you about since the beginning of that course. There is something called the mathematical rounding, which has nothing to do with our business here as a designer. We are always looking for the design rounding. And this design rounding is always going to the ceiling. It's not going to the top of the number. Yani, for example, if you are talking mathematically, these 2.1 should be two. I agree with you that this is from mathematical point of view. But from our point of view, this number should go to the to the ceiling, not the floor, which is supposed to be how much? Three.
Four.
And you go to the market, you find that there is no three. I'm not saying that this is if it's there or not, but I'm just giving you an example. And you see that whatever standard in the market is just 2, 4, 6, 8. So which one you recommend?
Four.
I have to go
four.
With four.
Four.
Masha Gama, I'm going to finish up my class here. I know I take a lot of time from you, but this information cannot be split into two pieces. I have to tell you the whole story. Almost, I told you the whole story, but still there is some step that we did not speak about, which is should I locate my point here and just this will be enough to reflect the whole scenario of failure on the opposite? No, you have to choose a point here and the point there and the point here and one here and one there and one there. And then you end up by drawing a tau primary and the tau double primary at each one. And there again, tau primary and tau double primary, because your torque is acting in that direction, should be perpendicular in the same direction of tau. Then you have another tau double primary. Okay, whatever you did up there, you would study, you would repeat it down there again. Tau primary, tau double primary, tau primary, tau double primary, tau primary, tau double primary in that direction. And then you would end up by having a numerous number of critical location. Man, this problem is very time consuming. No, don't worry. Actually, once you look at these six points, which are the worst points out of the total, out of the infinite number of points that you have to select, you will end up that there is only two points that you are worried about. Why? If you compare this one with that one, all the 12 primaries are the same. The only difference is in the tau double primary. And if you compare this tau double primary with that tau double primary, which one is bigger? This one is bigger because the R is bigger, right? This R is bigger than that R. You agree?
Yes, sure.
And then you end up by if you compare that one, this point with that point, then you will eliminate that one. You will never ever forget about that point in the middle because it's smaller. Whatever is the total here is smaller than the total. How did I know that the total is smaller? For two things. First of all, because one of the taus are smaller than that tau. And you know, guys, the smaller the angle in between, the bigger the resultant. Remember the vector analysis. When you have something like this, if this is F1 and this is F2, then you will end up by having a resultant like this. But what if for the same F1 and the F2, your angle become acute angle, then your resultant will become bigger. So from just the vision comparison, just a comparison by not the numbers, by just looking at the two points, then you can eliminate that point with respect to that one. You agree? And again, you will start comparing the point on the right with the point on the left. They are exactly the same in everything except the angle in between. And you see, guys, the angle in between is obtuse. If it's obtuse, this means that your resultant is getting smaller. So again, I'm going to cancel this one compared to that one. This is why you see that in his example, he just focused on that point because he knows from his experience that this will be the worst point in the picture. So what about the lower points? Similar. See, guys, this one is very similar to that one. And this one is very similar to that one, except only the directions. And this one is very similar to that one on the A, on the top. So why I study all of this? So although that you make your scenario by looking all, at all this picture, at all these points, but you end up by just making some numerical comparison between one or two points maximum in some of the cases that I will explain later, inshallah. Now, guys, it's clear?
It's clear? Yes, doctor. So determining the...
I will let you ask your question, but just very, 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 to conclude the steps of design. First, usually the unknown that we are looking for is the weld size, which is H itself. Okay? The first step is to move your force from its original point of application to the centroid. How can I get the centroid? I have to get the centroid from the table. The next step, you end up by calculating tau prime, which is equal to the force divided by area. Again, how can I get the area? Again, from the table. You go to the table and you look for the very similar case to your case. And then after you calculate your tau prime, you calculate your tau double prime. Again, tau double prime is equal to T times R divided by J. How can I get J? J is equal to J sub U from the table times 0.707H. And then you end up by having everything in terms of H. Then you have some points that you draw your tau prime and tau double prime at. And at each point, you make expectation for how the resultant will look like. And then you end up from just visual comparison that there is only one or maximum two points that you need to make actual calculation at these two points. And then you end up by making a tau total. And this tau total, you'll end up by making it equal to tau allowable. And then the only unknown that you are looking for will be there, H. Once you calculate H, then you go and search the market. If this H is closer to which one is in the standard. As you can see, this one is 2.1, which is closer to 2. But from the safety point of view, this is not accepted. Then I have to go and look for the next one, which is 4. This is the whole story, guys. And this is exactly what we're going to do, inshallah, this coming time before we move to the next topic. Again, is it clear or not?
Very clear, doctor.
Yes, doctor, clear.
Yes, clear.
Now, any questions before I leave?
Yes, just about the question in the WhatsApp group, doctor.
Table? You need me to go to the table?
No, the question in the WhatsApp group.
This is Khaled Al-Harbi, right?
Yes, doctor.
Okay, Khaled, I'll get back to you, but I'm asking if there is any question about this topic, guys. Okay, that's it. You are free to go. If you need to stay with us and listen to my answer to Khaled, please, you are very welcome to stay with us. Okay, let me get this.
One quick question. I want to ask about the previous lecture recordings. We still haven't got them on Blackboard. That's why we couldn't watch the lecture.
Mohammed, do you mean the recording of the last lecture?
Yeah.
Actually, it is in the Blackboard. The theory of ductile materials, right?
I mean, like, the lecture. For the last week, you know.
Yes, it's there.
I can't find it.
I will send you the link, okay?
Okay, thank you.
I will send you the link. Give me a second. Okay.
خالد الدكتور يكلمك في الواتساب.
محمد. Hello.
Yes, Mohammed. I have sent you the link of the record. So check.
Okay.
If
okay.
If that's what you're looking for.
Okay. Let me check.
Okay.
Because I was checking in the course contents for our course, and some of the lectures are missing. Sorry, in the announcements, and some of the lectures are missing there.
Yes, Mohammed. I was speaking to you, but the mic was off.
Nothing. I was just saying that some of the, like most of the
yes.
lectures are actually, not there. The
actually, what are in the announcement is just the lecture copied the link and put it in the announcement. But
okay.
The original locations where you can. It's in the Blackboard website itself. Go to the course, and then virtual classroom, and then on the
okay.
in the upper corner in the left, you'll find recordings. Just
oh.
click it, and you'll find all the recordings during all the yes.
Okay, I see it. Thank
That's
you so
it.
Much. Thank you so much. This was the one I was missing. Thank you.
Welcome, Hamad. Yes, welcome.
Okay. Thank you. Assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum.